Thank you for joining us. This is just breaking as we went live here. We'll cover it towards the end of the news tonight. Ron Paul has tied for first place in Iowa. The same numbers are coming in many other states across the country. The system is in panic mode. He's tied with the globalist, Newt Gingrich. And as people learn more about Gingrich, Gingrich is going to fall like a shooting star. We are witnessing history right now. More on that coming up. I also interviewed Ron Paul today on the radio. We'll be breaking down the incredible news nuggets that came out of that, including Ron Paul talking about the fact that Fast and Furious was a Justice Department criminal operation, in his words, to frame the Second Amendment and is a false flag attack against our country. That is coming up towards the end of the news segment. Before we air the second part of the interview, it's 45 minutes long. The second part is with Ben Fuchs, pharmacist Ben Fuchs, on the fact that it is basic science and molecular biology of how to be healthy and lose weight versus what the establishment medical system is selling. That extended part two of the interview they did live last night will air this evening, premiering here, so stay with us. We've also got some highlights of my radio / internet TV interview with Ron Paul today, so that's coming up after the news. Okay, let's look at drones. I remember 16 years ago, first being on the radio and learning about covert drone tests around the country and reading RAND Corporation and Pentagon prospectus plans on the fact that, hey, militaries never like to engage in guerrilla war because there's high casualties when you're dragging people's families off to re-education camps. But if we can get ground robots, air-based robots that are autonomous from humans, we can basically do whatever we want, even if the military says no. But in the interim, in that in-between step from having a fully human-operated military to the robot pre-programmed autonomous system, there's a middle ground, a transition phase. And the globalists, and we've written about this and posted it at Infowars.com many times, and had futurists on breaking it down, and MIT Magazine admits this as well, they went into a phase of having human operators for different drones drop bombs on people, blow up whole wedding parties in the Middle East or Africa or other areas to kill one, quote, terrorist. No judge, no jury, no nothing. Now we're told, hey, U.S. citizens, Obama has said, are being killed by drones. No judge, no jury, no wanted dead or alive even. Just, we're going to kill them. And now they're telling us they're going to operate and are operating domestically. And we're going to have TSA checkpoints and the Rural Affairs Commission run by the Pentagon and Homeland Security searching citizens. And so this has been going on for a long time. Now it's admitted. Drones officially take flight for domestic law enforcement. And the new ruling class, the paramilitary police and the military-industrial complex owned by offshore Goldman Sachs, they are openly saying that they're going to use these lethal systems against us. And they're now rolling it out publicly. And here's an article I have out of the Daily Mail. It first broke yesterday in the LA Times. Meet the North Dakota family of anti-government separatists. That's because they wanted to live alone. Busted by cops using a predator drone after stealing six cows. Now, the cows kept breaking into their property, and under common law and under U.S. law, we happen to have a ranch in East Texas, if all of this is going on, you get to keep the animals. In fact, once my grandpa got mad that his cows kept breaking into the neighbors three times and the neighbor kept a bunch of his cows. That's actually happened to me. Of course, a predator drone didn't go after the neighbor next door. It wasn't very neighborly, but it was his right to do it. But in today's parlance, when the family said, you're not coming on our property to get the cows without a warrant, they sent in the Air Force / CIA predator drone in the middle of the United States in North Dakota to do this. And targeted the enemy family, and the SWAT team went in. And I was on RT, National International Television, today, and they were asking me, in fact, I'll show folks a document cam shot of this article, and I'll show you the family here. They were asking, well, why is this happening now? Under the Rural Affairs Council, run by the Pentagon, under all of these systems, and I'm showing you again the wicked family that the media is demonizing, none of it is Al-Qaeda, the same folks our government has turned Libya over to. Or they used against the Russians or the Serbs or now the Syrians or the Iranians, for that matter. Al-Qaeda attacks all of them for the West in Saudi Arabia, who they work for. It's always about gun owners, rural people, people that are self-sufficient. You are the big enemy. You are the people that have to be targeted by police working with the military and the threat fusion centers, because when they implode the economy and take all the bank accounts, you're not going to want to leave your farmland that you own. And they're going to send in the police to kill you. And here's the big secret to all of this. Before they can X you out, before they can slit your throat, before they can hand it all over to Goldman Sachs as collateral for their next Ponzi scheme, before they can kill Mama, they've got to brainwash the public that you're a terrorist. They've got to sell the police it's okay to have the military involved. And I've got the manuals. We published them. MIAC, Homeland Security, the list goes on and on. Are you a homeschooler? Do you have your own farm? Do you own guns? They're training the cops that you're a terrorist. And I've got more news on that coming up in a moment. People are like, this can't be happening. Did it happen in Russia? Did it happen in Cuba? Did it happen in Nazi Germany? Did it happen in China? You got to start understanding that today in Mexico, if you try to protest, they shoot you. That comes out all the time in the news. This is how the rest of the world operates. And we think, oh, well, we're going to be okay here. No, we're not. Just because we own guns, the corrupt government, bought and paid for by the foreign banks, is amassing all this force against us. Weldon Henson works in my office. He got out of the Air Force 5 years ago when I hired him. He's a local country music singer as well, successful. But all of his buddies who were in the Air Force servicing F-16s, they're all being given jobs or offered jobs controlling drones. And now they're pilots. And they sit in trailers bombing people around the clock around the world. And this is about government not being scared to wage war against an armed population. And the entire posture and the admission by the Pentagon is they work, even one of the Army War College guys a few years ago talked about this, their enemy is the American people. And they work, quote, for Wall Street. That means the big mega banks that are getting all the government bailouts. It's a corporate takeover. You don't think Corzine would steal all those private bank accounts and be the top White House advisor to Obama without being told he's allowed to do this. They're setting the precedent. And make no mistake, hardcore tyranny has come here. In fact, pull up National Geographic before I get into more drone articles. National Geographic, I forgot to bring the hard copy up here, but here there's the online article. It shows the new combat robots. I was told a decade ago by people inside the Marine Corps and MIT that they had stuff that was like out of movies. Not little wheeled robots with machine guns and grenade launchers like you see in Iraq, the swords and stuff. That's 30 years old. Quite frankly, my grandfather was an inventor and developed a crowd control robot in the 1960s. They sold the prototype to and got their money back on that shot electrical cables out to taser people and had extendable arms that shocked people. And the government's always been obsessed with this. He sold the prototype, I think, was like 68 or so. So I've been close to this before anybody even knew about it. I was told about this when I was a kid and shown some of the documents. But expanding on this, my grandfather was like a tinker. He would go out and, you know, discover uranium and stuff with a weird scintillator machine he had. The point is that that's why last week when we showed The Treasure of Sierra Madres, that was his favorite movie, John Bound showed a clip of it. I'm like, wow, my grandpa used to love to watch that. Whenever it was on TV, he'd say, come over and watch it. It's in the TV guide. But side issue, going back to this, the whole thing is about getting humans out of the equations, having robots that work on the robots. And if you go back to that article, in the physical copy, they showed these big combat robots. They've got tanks, 18-wheelers that pull up in front of your house. A bunch of smaller legged or wheeled vehicles pull up. They come up to your house. They kill you. And zit-faced, pizza pocket-eating Ritalin heads sit back at their house slaughtering you, thinking that it's a video game. They've got all these new clocks coming out that have smells that bugs like, and the bugs go in and get killed, and you laugh at the flesh-eating robots. The Pentagon's coming out with flesh-eating ground robots that go out and kill humans and then feed themselves off human flesh. This is really happening. And so I want to warn everybody that this is going on. Fox News first, again, reported on the Eater. And so it is a Terminator Skynet situation. By the way, that movie is all based on what the Pentagon plans. It's just the machines aren't going to be working for machines. They work for humans. They're eugenicists. I want to get rid of the population. In the 70s, before the Skynet space-based Star Wars system was announced as the Strategic Defense Initiative, back before it was declassified, it was called Skynet. And they called the cashless society system the control grid. Truth is stranger than fiction. Now, every time I'm on national TV or radio, I mention, hey, they've already got at 150,000 feet or higher, super high altitude blimps that are robotically controlled from the ground. They have ground penetrating radar on them. They've got microwave systems that can actually cook you in your house. You die 6 months later, what you think's cancer or a blood-based cancer like leukemia. This was all set up by Alexander Haig in the 90s. He owned the big company the government contracted for this. I mean, I remember back in 2005 articles about the blimps being launched. And now ABC News, whenever people get a telescope out and show it, go, is that a flying saucer over Salt Lake or Dallas? Even when the news shows a blimp with propellers that's solar powered. I mean, it's a blimp. I have the answers. I called ABC News up. And I called the Dallas stations up, and I said, that's a blimp. You can see propellers. They said, no, we're saying it's an alien. And I showed the newscast where they said it must be an alien. Because the public isn't allowed to see a giant blimp surveilling them with microwave cannons on the bottom. They just tell you it's a space alien, even though it's a Hindenburg with propellers on it. Again, they're the conspiracy theorists. They feed you on superstition and tribe, like the UN last week saying, give them control over all energy or Mother Earth will die and the rights of the Gaia spirit. Whether you believe that or not, they don't. It's pure quackery. Yeah, there it is. ABC News, desperate to ignore Homeland Security blimp claims, UFO over Salt Lake City. Yeah, the Daily Polygus reported on that a few years ago. But yeah, I guess they were kind of picking up on our article because we were the ones that pointed that out. But that's what it is. That's what it is. I mean, it's a blimp with propellers. It's like showing a locomotive and saying, kids, it's a space alien or it's a dragon. The government's like, locomotives don't exist. It's a fire-breathing dragon who's friends with Keebler elves and Easter bunnies. This is what they do. But here's MSNBC. Eyes in the sky for Homeland Security, and it is the giant drone. So they're going after everybody. They're going after folks who, you know, finally the fourth time keep cows that go on their property. I remember I'd warn you about they're going to use drones and armored. I saw an article years ago in Hawaii where the police are testing giant vehicle-sized mini tanks with weapons all over them. And the cowards sit back. You won't leave your ranch because it belongs to Goldman Sachs now. Under some New World Order program, they're threatening robots in Greece. They're just going to march robots out for that you paid for to slaughter your ass. I mean, I'm sorry, that's what this is. Yeah, there's one of their little killer robots. Biomass-eating military robot is a vegetarian company, says. After they first put out a press release about flesh-eating ones, they came out with this. Isn't that sweet? It's not going to eat your corpse. There will be a corpse, though. Okay, let's continue here. Here's the unmanned aerial vehicle and the National Aerospace System. See, when my grandpa had to fly over Europe flying a Liberator and a B-17, he flew both. You know, he had to actually go and fight humans. But see, now they just sit back cowardly and have a march out against you. And they don't care if the military says no to killing Americans because it all works for Skynet now. And everything's got back doors built into it, Trojan horses, your cell phone, your appliances are all coming out to track you. It's all admitted. But because everybody knows that's Big Brother, they first say, oh, that's not true. Oh, that's not happening. Now it's admitted. Oh, we're never going to use the drones, you know, $5 million predators, $13, $14 million sentinels. We're never going to use them against you. I remember 8, 9 years ago, Homeland Security was first set up tracking farmers in Colorado. Were they building a new barn on their property without paying the local environmental tax? It's the same thing in Australia. The government thinks it owns us. It thinks it's its right. It's like Texas last week bought six new $600,000 boats apiece to go out and wage war against us with cannons and machine guns on it while they tell us they want our guns and leave all the real criminals alone. We have a money laundering criminal government. And until you admit that, we have no hope. I mean, the Justice Department's been caught shipping drugs into the country, guns into Mexico. There it is. Drone aircraft may prowl U.S. skies. Already doing it. L.A. to test crime-fighting drone. Drone aircraft will be used to nab illegal immigrants on California-Mexico border. Not. And again, Those poor people are coming here from Mexico because the UN 20 years ago took all their property. They come to families on record. This is happening in Latin America right now in Africa. We've covered the articles. They come in there. It was called the Machete War. They've had several of them in the area there in southeastern Mexico in Yucatan. They had one just 20 years ago. And they come and say, show us the deed to your property. Well, there's a cemetery. My family for 1,000 years is buried there. They say, sorry, you're off. They stick a UN sign on it, sell it for hotel developers, you name it. We used to go to Mexico twice a year when I was a kid to that area. There were always little shops, bed and breakfasts, businesses, happy people. I was there 2 years ago and said, where are all the fishermen? And they said, no more fishermen allowed. Only the big companies are allowed to come and fish. Old men can't go catch fish for their family. There's literally no fishing boats in Cozumel. No fishing boats along that entire area. I've been all over Mexico. There's nobody there. There's nobody but the big companies now. The people are all gone. When I was there as a kid, there were people everywhere, living happily. They were all forced into Mexico City that was 10 million people. Now it's 35 million. Half the population lives in cardboard boxes and literally gets water a few hours a day out of faucets filled with toxic waste. One-third of the babies in Mexico City are born with a disorder. I forget the name, you can pull it up, of literally no brains, like a tiny brain. They're like born as vegetables. They're now going to inject the entire child population. First it was girls 2 months ago, now it's everybody, with Gardasil that's known to sterilize them. Genocide is going on in mass. And then all these people pour across the border. The government's there to say, oh, here's some welfare on top of your regular job to drive down wages. And by the way, guns are bad. You're going to vote for that, aren't you? Yeah, just get me out of here. I'll vote to take the guns. Boom, they're pouring in. The globalists have imploded Mexico. Everything's falling apart. In Africa and in Honduras, it came out in the last 2 months. The UN goes in. Even the New York Times admits it. And shoots people who won't leave their property. And I'm telling you, that's coming here to America. All the documents are about rural populations. If you're not dependent on them and in some big compact city where they can drain your bank account anytime they want, you're the enemy. And they don't care the Pentagon's waking up. They don't care the military is supporting Ron Paul, because within 5 years, the Pentagon believes 80% of their aircraft and their ground forces are going to be robot. You don't think that's true? Imagine the trillions they spend, upwards of $2 trillion a year here domestically, more than half the world's defense budget in the U.S. You think they could just churn out toasters and DVD players and stuff? No. How about an 18-wheeler that pulls up with guns all over it, robot-controlled, without even human... In fact, they won't believe it. I forgot to give you this article, guys. Google Air Force to launch autonomous drones. And you pre-program them, they go out, and they already have them. They're already killing people in the, quote, test. I cannot warn you enough about how serious this is. I cannot bring you words. How much of what I told you previously has come true? I'm telling you the rest of the story now. Believe me, you think stuff's bad, this is only the beginning. I'm getting chills. This is only the preparatory phase of what humanity is going through right now. Yeah, but we can beat these people if we're aware of it. Air Force, technology. Tyrannus, United Kingdom. And I guess that's a UK announced. Yeah, that's their copy of the stealth fighter. No. Let me think of the exact headline. It's something like Air Force testing drones that operate without human control. Drones without human control. I covered like a month ago on the radio. The point is that they're going to phase into that area. That's where this is going. All right, continuing here. There's the government documents on it. Here it is. Now, getting into other issues. You can keep looking, and then once we find it, you can get it. Okay, Air Force testing drones without human control. Just say government testing, Pentagon testing, autonomous drones. Or testing drones that kill on their own. And again, they're already in the field. Now, again, I do all this in front of you so you can learn. I'm just here showing you what you can find out for yourself. Armed robotic drones, that might be it. Oh, it doesn't matter. It's all over the news. There's a danger room. What's next for national security? I'll think of the exact headline in a moment. The point is, this is already going on. Once I get something in my mind, I've got to find it. Look, look, I'll just find it. We have to. I'll cover it tomorrow night, okay? We'll have 20 articles for them. The point is, they're going... Nope, that's it. I'm going to stop right now here on air. Okay, because I can't stand watching you search. I'm going to think of the exact name. Hold on just a minute. I'm going to do it. Here we go. Drones, drones, drones. It was... By the way, this is not some parlor bit, folks. I come up with this stuff I've read and researched, and then I can't find it. It drives me crazy. Military testing drones that make decisions for themselves or something like that. Try that. This is driving me crazy. If I can't find it, call Watson. He can always find it even better than I can. One of the few skills he surpasses me in. Okay, let's go ahead and get into the other news. As I said earlier, I told you, oh, there it is. There it is. You found it. Alternet. But I think the one I found was New York Times. The rise of killer drones that can think for themselves. The U.S. military, maybe a decade or so away, they always tell you that when it's already in place, from deploying an army of pilotless drones capable of collaborating and killing without any human guidance. Bull. Yeah, this is October 2nd. This is from November, the one. They're already testing them. There must be crazy-haired mad scientists roaming the U.S. military research laboratories unsupervised. The most reasonable explanation for the military's latest advanced drone technology. No! The elites don't want militaries that can say no to them. It's all about control. Use that similar headline, though. It's MIT being reported on the New York Times, I think. Oh, you found a Washington Post. A future for drones, automated killing. You see? Did I lie to you? There it is right there. And this has always been their goal. I knew this from documents in the 70s that I read in the late 90s. And I covered in my book, Descent into Tyranny, online at PrisonPlanet.tv. Again, look at that. Ground drones, armored troop carrier drones. Yeah, look, they have robot command centers that dump out killer ground robots, launch small spy robots out of the top. You can look at these online Pentagon videos. You've got the autonomous land killer. You got the UAV in the up above. And again, this will all be used against you. The little control freak psycho cops, they're not even going to be needed soon. That's why they aren't getting rid of the cops yet to write tickets. They're just going to use the license plate readers and stuff to do that because they don't want them to freak out their unions to say no. But they're going to be done. All humans are going to be is repairing these killers. I've talked to Marines a decade ago, and a few years ago I talked to a Marine Corps officer. I'll leave it at that. They've got killer robots. They've even got them for psyops with like big demon heads and skull heads on them. What you see in the Terminator movies is actually a psyop. So when you see that, you're going to freak. Look, it's a rubber mask thing. It can be defeated. And remember, you can always find the humans that are running them and controlling them. And you can always get to the factories. I know you're not going to listen now, but it's all a Pentagon plan. We're going to defeat these eugenicists. They think their Prozac in the water, their chemicals in the food are going to control us. If you're conscious of the enemy's operations, you can defeat it. You see, you notice all their attempts to call us conspiracy theorists and demonize us when we have the documents, it's only going to backfire. Everybody who was kept in the dark is only getting angry now that they were kept in the dark. All right, I got to move now. How long have I been going here? 23 minutes. I got to shut this down a minute and get to the rest of the Ben Fuchs information, another revolution of how to keep their poison out of us and how to get healthy. And I've just begun my journey. That's coming up. Sheriff Department sponsors secret meeting of small government terrorist. And this is a standard procedure. Your traitorous government, trained by the ADL and Southern Poverty Law Center, and we have links to it, literally sits around all day saying they like George Washington. If they own guns, they're terrorists. And I've shown you the training manuals. The Ventura County Sheriff's Department has teamed up with the Anti-Defamation League, same folks that got convicted of breaking into police departments to get files on citizens, a quasi-secret meeting in Camarillo, California that characterizes small government activists as violent terrorists. And if you want any, don't want banker bailouts, don't want corruption, want local control, you are listed as a terrorist and put in a file. Let the terrorists put us in files. They're the un-American terrorists. They're the 21st century authoritarians. They're the ones that are going to get beaten. This is all a test for humanity. They're the little control freaks that love all the weapons and the spying and listening to our phones without warrants, run by ADL, a known lobbying group for Israeli intelligence that thinks America's run by them. Let them try to take our police over. We're just going to expose it. I mean, it's on. We will defend the republic against enemies foreign and domestic. And so the globalists can try this stuff all day. But there's the report. The sovereign citizen movement, like the people with the cows that they used the Pentagon Air Force drone on. That's what they called them. Sovereign citizen. Oh my gosh, they're saying I'm not a slave. They've got to be dealt with. Whatever. Your apartheid's going to fail. It's apartheid against people that want basic freedom to be treated like a human. You want to create a race war, you're going to fail. The people are going to come together and recognize this. Let's continue here. Again, I told you it's a war on rural people. I've always told you that because I've got their documents. Here it is. The drones, all of it. There it is. You're the enemy. And a foreign Israeli-run group, and I'm not enemies with Israel. Governments try to take over other governments. That's what Israel's done. Just like China's tried to take over the U.S. They're operating for their interest. I'm saying keep your hands off our farms and ranches and our guns and stop demonizing people that are Americans and want our basic freedoms back. It's that simple. Okay? You know, can't we have guns like Israeli citizens are handed guns? Why is the ADL lobby to take our guns? Because ADL thinks we're their property. I'm not your property, and you know it. Okay, let's continue. Obama wants Iran to return downed drone. Speaking of drones, rather than asking for a return of the high-tech spy craft, Iran has suggested Obama should apologize for violating its sovereignty. Yeah, they're talking about attacking Iran over this, and Iran's talking about shutting down the Strait of Hormuz. Let's go to one of the most pathetic clips of Obama. I guess his teleprompter wasn't loaded. And he's trying to act all reasonable when his attorney general shipping drugs into the country on record and guns out of the country and got caught lying to Congress. You know, he's there saying, you know, give me the drone back. By the way, Iran's getting its bases blown up. They don't want to act powerless that they're being bombed. But the West is already bombing them. That's now admitted. And it's like, how dare you not let us get intelligence to bomb you more? How dare you not be our good little slave? And again, I know it's fun to hate Ahmadinejad. People can't find the country on a map. And he's got brown skin, so he must be evil. The point is, in Iran, they don't pay their population to have abortions. In Iran, they're not trying to shoot people up with deadly Gardasil shots. That's why they must be destroyed. Well, let's go ahead and go to that clip of our lordship, Barack Obama.
The drone inside of Iran, I'm not going to comment on intelligence matters that are classified. As has already been indicated, we have asked for it back. We'll see how the Iranians respond.
They relish how asleep the American public is. Though we're starting to awaken, you see the velvet glove coming off the iron fist. They relish acting all establishment while they engage in every manner of crime known to man. They love it. And they just keep counting on the general public being ignorant and playing into the fact that, oh, I'm with the system, I'm a winner. The only way you're a winner is standing against this tyranny. It's the only future we have. We've got links to all the different sources, but U.S. special forces are massing on the Syrian border, just like they did with al-Qaeda forces a few months ago to invade Libya and take over Tripoli. And there's the report, U.S. special forces mass on Syria border, Infowars.com. We have links to Sybil Edmonds and also papers in the Middle East and the Debka file out of Israel reporting on the fact that is going on. So we have just more globalist takeover happening, more globalist invasions, all financed by the American people. Continuing, cleansed Libyan town spills its terrible secrets. You know, we tried to warn you about this back in September as it was beginning. It was confirmed, obviously, that Libya is in Africa, so it's a black homeland. But the Arabs in the last 300 years or so have moved into the area, and that's fine. Most Arabs and blacks get along and intermarry and stuff. But Gaddafi was friends with everybody. Not saying he's a good guy, not saying he's a bad guy. But he wasn't al-Qaeda, you know, the sword of the New World Order, the sword of the Illuminati, who's been used against the entire planet, including the U.S., to take our liberties. It's a kind of a skeleton key to open every door for the globalists. And al-Qaeda came in, and in some towns, one case killed hundreds black women and children and men. There's videos we showed hacking them up, the kids, the women, you know, the kids' faces blown off. It's all very humanitarian. And just like when the UN goes in and slaughters a black village, it's trending. I mean, as long as it's UN, lining a little kid up and blowing their head off, I mean, this is what good guys do. I mean, come on, it's trendy. So I want to show you a brief report, because now it's all admitted that 30,000 people in from one town have been driven out of their homes. in what appears to have been an act of revenge for their role in the three-month siege of the city of Misrata. So what really happened in the town, and it goes on, where they try to whitewash it in the BBC. All of you, quote, liberals who really are a bunch of fascist tyrannizers, feel good about the Nazi love that you have. I mean, your camouflage has worked well, but you mid-level folks, feel good about the 40,000 conservatively dead blacks in Libya, 30,000 driven out of one town, hacked up with machetes, machine gunned. I mean, feel good about what you are. Own it. Because Lord knows you're not going to come out. You think later you're going to kind of, in the BBC, go, oh, this is too bad, this happened. And then you're going to get away with what you've done spiritually. I know you don't believe in God. Karmically. The only way to get around this is to repent for it and to speak out against what you've been involved in. And if you don't, it's on you. Okay? It's on you. All of you that push the vaccines without researching it, and all the untold death and cancer and sterilization. All of you pushing Gardasil and the deaths and illness here and the untold death and illness in Mexico that's now unfolding as the shots begin. It's on you. And the fact that you trust this system so much. So I thought I'd show you this report from, I don't know, how many months ago? Yes, this is 2 months ago. This is September 2nd. It's now December 13th. September 2nd, here we are breaking down what happened with our report, Black Genocide in Libya. Here it is.
Destruction of the spirit of the people.
We've seen racist accusations thrown at our leaders in the past.
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
But Barack Obama was supposed to be different. He was supposed to be a champion to all. But now we see that our participation in Libya and the current conflict is a direct correlation to the images you're about to see. Here we see the town of Tawurga and a massacre of the blacks that have lived there. Their hands were bound behind their backs and they were shot in the head. Black-run businesses are being burned all across Libya, and blacks are being rounded up in the back of pickups and taken to prison camps. The dogs of war have been unleashed, and we can expect to see more images of racist attacks on black Africans by Al-Qaeda-backed forces. The next time someone claims you're a racist for not supporting Obamacare, isn't the U.S. and NATO-backed genocide against black Africans the real racist agenda? Remember, Libya is not Bush's war. It was started by Barack Obama, a president who has roots in Africa and is using black cover to do the bidding of the New World Order.
But see, now if you're not for killing 40,000 blacks, you're against black people. Literally, I'm like, there's a Obama just increased all the forced abortion funding for Africa, where they tell women, we'll let you out of this debt, we'll give you money, just let us sterilize you, kill that baby, and then let us tie your tubes. And it's like, oh, that's trendy. I've had black leaders here in my studio. I did an interview with one months ago. I didn't even air it. Just because I can't be involved in this. And he was like, no, I don't want to discuss abortion. I don't want to discuss the targeting of blacks with this stuff. And I'm just like, you know, that's the litmus test right there. Again, I don't have some white guilt. Folks, people enslave, people do whatever. They use excuses to do it. Humans are all the same. See, I don't have some guilt here. I feel good about who I am. I sleep good at night. Even though the globalists could kill me or set me up any day. Because I know I'm a good person. I don't give a rat's behind what color you are. It's the content of your mind, the content of your deeds. That's what I stand for. And you will not see the black leaders ever do anything because they're bought and paid for political whores. Black America, white America, Hispanic, Asian America, whatever the case is, you're not going to find leaders with who they're shoveling at you on the nightly news. Not Al Sharpton, not Jesse Jackson, not any of these globalists, Obama, Newt Gingrich, any of them. You're going to have to do some research to find the truth. And quite frankly, you just stumbled right in the middle of it. I don't need to sit here and defend myself. I know what I say is researched. I know what I'm talking about. And I'm begging you to realize what you're seeing here. I know subscribers know, but people out there watching this on the web, this isn't a game. You think tyranny's a game? Study history. It's not a game. And it's about to go into a very sick level. And then still sicker after that. That's why I'm so desperate to warn people. It's why I can pour my heart and soul out. Not because I'm some humanitarian, but because I want to survive. And to survive, we've all got to survive together. They always sell groups on, let's kill this group and you'll do good. And then you're the next group they kill. A great microcosm of this is Bill Gates, we played the clip a lot. We should do another report on this. We played it probably 10 times this year on radio and TV. We got up and said, yeah, they're called death panels. Not a very popular term, but I'll use it. You don't give grandma treatment that last year. And you can hire 10 teachers. And the teachers group was like, yay, they're like, kill grandma. Do you idiots think you're really going to get part of that money from killing grandma? You just lower the standard for everybody. That's what NAFTA and GATT and all of it is about. When you pick up your own trash at McDonald's, you're not getting a better price on the food. You're lowering the standard everywhere where people eat at dirty tables. You're destroying entry-level jobs. When you don't want a service attendant to pump your gas, which phased out all the people servicing your car, you destroy the level of service. A society is unlimited in what it can build. And the anthropologists, the economics experts, they know all this. It gets sophisticated, but the point is, they're trying to train us to accept less and less. I got articles on that coming up. So Klein's living in town, spills his terrible secrets. Now the BBC, because mission's accomplished, can now feel sorry about those that they slaughtered. The BBC were warmongering whoremongers who loved it. The rest of the whore media as well. The blood's on your hands. All those kids with their lower mandibles blown off, with their tongues hanging out, screaming in pain and death. It's all yours. I hope you enjoy owning that. Not in my name. I'll risk my life here to expose these murderers and go through all the harassment so it's not on my soul. And not because I'm even scared and superstitious. I can feel evil that's done in my name. I can feel change, like in A Christmas Carol. You know, the story of Scrooge, when he's talking to his old business partner with all the chains and everything, and he goes, your chains and weights are much bigger. When I do something wrong, folks, I can feel the chain on me. You understand that? And because you're spiritually blind, you can't feel it. I want these chains off of me. You understand that? I don't, I'm going to stop preaching here. I'm going to stop it. I'm wound up tonight. False rumor that Strait of Hormuz was closed sends oil prices skyrocketing. Confusion caused by military drill rattles markets. Oil exploded in prices today. But again, I was reading this headline. Look, the Iranians said Monday, we're going to do a drill to shut it down. And that itself driving it up, what, $3, which is huge in one day. I mean, what do you expect markets to do? And of course, some media then said, oh my God, they're going to block it. But really, they said, we're going to do a drill for blocking it. But this gives you an idea of what's going to happen if they actually do block it. They're talking $200 to $500. I kept saying $200 to $300. Now the analysts are $200 to $500, $350 being what they mainly think it's going to settle in on. SOPA is unconstitutional and criminalize the internet. China is the model. That's a Washington blog article, but that was actually run as a headline in what the Weekly Standard said the exact same thing and broke that all down. I covered that on the radio, the Hill blog, all over the Washington Post, admitting this is a selective kill switch. One headline was a kill switch on free speech. So it's here, it's admitted, they're trying to pass it to selectively shut down whoever they want because they've committed all these crimes. They're not going to give Corzine the green light to steal billions and others. They're like, oh, Madoff got in trouble. We've got to, you know, just totally take over. So they can steal everything because they want to be in total control. Now, shifting gears, remember this article, December 2nd, 2011, and we first reported on this back in February. Draconian EPA regulations to cause rolling blackouts. Critics attacked by White House for making connection proven accurate. The White House attacked PrisonPlanet.com and the article I did with Paul Watson back in February. And then since then, all these major commissions have come out and said, yeah, you're going to have rolling blackouts. Your power prices are basically going to double. Okay? And here's the article. So, as we keep telling you, the globalists want to sell you less for more, the post-industrial model. And it's all about breaking your will with the TSA, hands down the pants, all of it. It's about getting past barriers, putting drones in the sky, having smart boxes, smart meters, control the temperature in your house, new appliances with chips in them, with information over the power line, tracking what you do in your house. It's all admitted. I'd tell people about this because it was in MIT documents 15 years ago. Folks laughed. Now it's in your face. It's unlimited tyranny, just like they've done in third world countries. It's their model of control. Bankrupt you, make you homeless. You'll be happy to just have a roof over your head. Put paramilitary police in over you and your family. This is the tyranny. This is the new dark ages of the new world order that must be opposed. Now, let me go ahead and give you some good news. Okay, at least we know what they're doing. At least we're awake to this insider mafia takeover that we're facing. Let me give you some good news. The Orlando Sentinel is reporting Broward is looking at a request to ban body scanners at airports until they can prove they're safe, because it's come out that they've lied about their safety and top scientists say they are deadly. So the good news is that Broward is mulling requests to ban body scanners at airport. They go on to say that until they can prove that it's safe, they're going to move to ban it. TSA spokesman Jonathan Allen in Atlanta couldn't say whether his agency would follow the county's request. He said it's the agency's policy to not comment on pending legislation, but he said the agency is satisfied with the request report by the Department of Homeland Security Inspector General, which concluded that backscatter technology is well within national standards of safe for all passengers. Yeah, the EPA's raised radiation levels and says higher levels is safer now. Just amazing. Now, looking at one more piece of TSA news, we were sent this by a listener today that they took there in Broward County at the Fort Lauderdale, Florida airport. And Santa Claus, you can see his red top there and then his pants. Santa Claus, someone playing the part of Santa Claus who was trying to fly, was basically groped by TSA to make sure that they weren't an Al-Qaeda. After all, they had a beard, so they must be evil. Now let's get into the good news on the Ron Paul front. Ron Paul ties with Newt Gingrich in the latest Iowa PPP poll, and it goes through all of those numbers. And of course, that's even with skewed polls, he's tying. The truth is, he's not number two in most states, he's number one, and Newt Gingrich is a total globalist. If we expose him, he will implode. Now, I want to go to a video clip here of some of the questions I asked Ron Paul today, and then we're going to go to break and come back with Aaron Dykes in part two of the interview he started on air, but that went over with pharmacist Ben Fuchs, on the secrets of disease, the secrets of nutrition, and how to reverse so many of these diseases. Incredible information with pharmacist Ben Fuchs coming up after this Ron Paul clip in the break. But here are the latest articles at Infowars.com. Ron Paul on my show today, the radio show, said Fast and Furious is a criminal false flag stage terror attack against America. And that interview is up there in full and broke down the fact that Eric Holder is a criminal. So very bold, telling the truth. In a world of universal deceit, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. And another big tidbit of many in the interview, Ron Paul said defense bill establishes martial law in America. Congressman condemns bold, arrogant, dangerous move to intern Americans without trial. And we'll cover more of that on the radio tomorrow. But these reports are so bombshell, so please get them out to everyone you know. In closing, before we go to some excerpts of the Ron Paul interview from the radio today, I want to just say incredible job to the crew and thank all of you for watching and spreading the word out there. This is teleprompter-free news. So some nights it's 30 minutes, some nights it's 2 hours. I think we've ever actually done 30 minutes, but it's always 35 minutes or 2 hours, an hour long, whatever the case is. Thank you for supporting us. Because you who are subscribers to PrisonPlanet.tv, you see it when it first airs. You see the higher quality archives, all the films, the books, the other interviews in one spot. Almost 9 years of material. But you pay it forward and support as an information warfare outreach to the millions every week that watch this on YouTube and other video platforms. So I want to thank all of you that are PrisonPlanet.tv subscribers. If you're not a subscriber, people loved it so much. Next week, we're bringing back the 15-day free trial on the yearly or the monthly, but right now we're also running a special we do every year during December where you can get 44% off a year membership. You pay for 6.7 months, you get 5.3 months free. We've got some other specials as well that are 70% off right now at PrisonPlanet.tv or Infowars.com. So remember, when you buy the books, the t-shirts, the materials, you not only get powerful films and tools to wake others up, you support the command base here in the fight against tyrants. We're risking our lives, our name, our sacred honor. We appreciate you risking some of your treasure in the fight against tyrants. But you can get in the ditch and lick their boots. No one can deny that we're at the tip of the spear and right here beside and behind Ron Paul. Okay, let's go to some excerpts of this Ron Paul interview we did today, and then we'll go to the Ben Fuchs interview with Aaron Dykes, the part we didn't air last night. God bless you all. So all the Republicans here in Austin are going to protest Eric Holder, the attorney general, today because he wants the UN to oversee our elections. And I agree, that's certainly out of control and treasonous. But this is the guy caught perjuring himself, and the memos CBS released last week show that they said they were going to blame the guns in Mexico on the Second Amendment. Is that not a form of false flag against our most basic of rights, sir? And what would you do, if president, to people like Eric Holder?
Well, he should be immediately fired, and then there should be an investigation and find out if charges should be made. And that's obviously over the top. And all these kind of sting operations and false flag, this is criminal. And I think they do it constantly. I think they were doing that when there was this so-called attempt to kill the Saudi or the Iranian ambassador. You know, that kind of stuff is just way too much. But no, they should be investigating. And you know, that's one thing I think the government House committee is doing a pretty good job at investigating that. But I don't know whether charges will be made, but he deserves to have charges, you know, up against him.
Well said, and you got it right the first time. The claim of the used car sales and wanting to kill the Saudi ambassador, and even mainstream media had to admit that was totally phony and a pretext to attack Iran.
Yeah, that was the real excuse to blame it on them, and we know that is. You know, I just wonder about that, whether that guy will ever get tried, because if he does, maybe the truth will come out. And sometimes they won't try these people because they don't want the truth to come out. So it's just another propaganda stunt, as far as I'm concerned.
Now they want to go after Syria. It's now admitted the U.S., Israel, and others are staging giant military attacks inside Iran. What do you make of Congress not being consulted on that?
Well, unfortunately, that's been happening for a long time, and Congress is just totally negligent on this. And you know, the other night when they were talking about this in the debates, you know, on what the president's responsibility is when they you know, shoot down or are able to get one of our drones, and the argument was, should we go in and get it, or should we just go in and destroy it? And I tried to get attention on that. My suggestion would be, why don't we avoid it by not sending drones over a sovereign nation just looking for a problem to start another war? I mean, they never talked about, you know, the lack of wisdom of having been over there and losing a drone over a foreign nation, which we consider an enemy. I just think that is it's a reflection of a policy that has to be changed.
What's your view on the NDAA and the end of Posse Comitatus and the declaration of the whole world as a battlefield?
Yeah, well, I think the significant difference is not so much in what they have done, but the announcement and the arrogance of it all, that they actually put it into law. You know, our government's been involved with our CIA and involvement in overthrowing governments and this for a long, long time. And, of course, last spring, I guess it was in February, where the administration admitted that they could assassinate American citizens, and now they're putting it into law. So this to me is an extremely wrong way to go. This is a giant step. This should be the biggest news going right now. It's literally legalizing martial law. And yet, you know, in our debates, how often does it come up? It didn't come up at all. You know, and then the arrogance, and this is the one thing Rand got stopped, the arrogance of them trying to push through on their voice vote that if you go through a trial and found innocent, the government wants the right to put you in prison for life anyway. And fortunately, they wanted to do that in voice vote, and he finally got a vote on that, and that was canceled out. But that is arrogance of the administration and neglect of the Congress in using their authority and responsibility, as well as the people. That's why it's up to so many of us now to wake the people up, because they don't probably realize the significance of it. But this is big. This is big. You know, the monetary issue is big, all these things I've talked about. But this step where they can literally arrest American people, American citizens, and put them away without a trial, and you heard Lindsey Graham say, well, if they ask for a lawyer, tell them no lawyer for you. I mean, that is arrogant and bold and dangerous. Let's hope and pray that we can get that kind of stuff reversed.
What's up with these sorry politicians? Lots of bark. When it's showtime, whimpering like little shih tzus. You want big cuts. Ron Paul's been screaming it for years. Budget crisis? No problem. Cut $1 trillion year one. That's trillion with a T. Department of Education, gone. Interior, Energy, HUD, Commerce, gone. Later, bureaucrats. That's how Ron Paul rolls. Want to drain the swamp? Ron Paul, do it.
I'm Ron Paul, and I approve this message.
If you believe in this information and want to support its viral spread, go to the InfoWars store at InfoWars.com. We've got the new G.I. Joe InfoWars t-shirts. We've got the incredible ProPure gravity-fed filters available at InfoWars.com in the store. We've got a new DVD, Sinus Under Attack, the Don't Tread on Me flag. We've got all sorts of different bumper stickers to help spread the rebellion virally. It's all there, wristbands, citizen rule books, in every order. Order online at InfoWars.com today. The water filters, the canteens, it's all there. InfoWars.com.
We're back at the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm Aaron Dykes. Now, on Monday, we spoke at length with Ben Fuchs, but there's so much more. He's a registered pharmacist, by the way. He's going to tell you about his background, and we're going to get into how you can use nutrition and really just general knowledge about your health to address your own issues, but also specifically to disengage from the tyrannical systems that we face today. It really is an InfoWar that applies to your own health as well. Think about how much knowledge they've kept from us. And the quote we were talking about during the break, the people perish for lack of knowledge. And that includes submitting to a centralized system on all fronts, including food, nutrition, health, and the rest of it. So, Ben, let's get back into it. Last time we spoke in depth about your list, the first two or three on there, the importance of protein and fat intake for losing weight and for gaining good health. And where does the list go from there?
Well, also protein and fat for cravings. Remember, your body's going to crave certain things. And if your brain is telling you you need fat and you need sugar, you're not going to be able to use willpower to get it. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to hit the brain's satisfaction buttons. For sugar, use protein. For fat, use essential fatty acids. The last thing we talked about when we talked last was carbohydrates. Carbohydrates get a bad rap. Because most of the carbohydrates people think about are refined processed carbohydrates or grain-based carbohydrates. Now, we didn't get to talk about grains, but they're a serious problem. And I think we mentioned the fact that political hegemony evolved, co-evolved, with our ability to process and agriculture and grow grains. So grains are a big problem, sugar is a big problem, and when people think about carbohydrates, they typically think about grains and sugar, or refined sugars and refined grains, so they always want to be on a low-carb diet. Now, when it comes to grains and sugars, that's true. You do want to be on a low-carb diet when you're referring to grains and sugars, but when it comes to vegetables, you don't want to be on a low-carb diet. You want to be on a high vegetable intake diet and take as much, eating as much vegetables as you want. Last time we talked about the environmental protective factors that are found in vegetables as well. So, chapter three is carbohydrates. When you think carbohydrates, you want to make sure you're getting most of your calories from carbohydrates, but they need to be vegetable carbohydrates, whatever that takes. If it means a salad for breakfast, if it means vegetable juice all day long, using veggie juices, whatever it takes, you want about a pound of vegetables for every 50 pounds of body weight. So if you weigh 150 pounds, you're looking at 3 pounds of vegetables a day. It's a lot of vegetables for most people. Yeah. A couple big salads a day, two or three big salads a day. The next, if we can just continue, the next chapter, chapter four, is fiber. And fiber has a couple of very important roles to play. One of the most important roles fiber plays for weight loss is it expands your stomach. And when your stomach is expanded, signals are sent to your brain that say, I'm full, and it shuts down the appetite. So eating more fiber is a great way to fill yourself up and shut down your appetite, and there's lots of ways to do it. One of my favorite ways is nuts, especially almonds. And when you're using nuts or you're using fiber, especially if you're using them to fill up, to lose weight, make sure you drink lots of water with your fiber. There's two main kinds of fiber, by the way. There's soluble fiber, which is the kind of fiber that's in peaches or pears, this kind of squishy fiber. And then there's solid fiber or insoluble fiber, which comes from nuts or seeds. It's like the kind of fiber that's in a stalk of celery when you peel that little wire off, or the kind of fiber that's in the shells of nuts. They're both important. You need both kinds. They're especially important for the digestive system. And we didn't get to talk about digestive health, but there is no system in the body more important to take care of than the digestive system, and there's no system in the body that will mess your life up worse than the digestive system, than problems in the digestive system. There's a commercial on TV about Crohn's disease, and there's a lady, and she talks about
how it popped up virtually out of nowhere.
You know what? Yeah, it did, right? Crohn's disease is a classic food-based disease. And she says in the commercial, the whole line is, oh, are you worried about Crohn's disease? You can't go to parties and you can't go out at night because you'll never... Basically, what they're saying is you're going to have to go to the bathroom every few minutes when you have these kinds of intestinal diseases. Well, let me tell you something. One of the best ways to protect yourself from a digestive disease is to make sure you're getting enough fiber. There's lots of other ways, too, but that's one of the best ways. You want, by the way, around 4 tablespoons of fiber a day. Most of us are lucky if we get a teaspoon of fiber every day. My favorite way to make fiber, or to get fiber, is to make your own fiber, where you get yourself a little coffee grinder, put some flax seeds in there, press the button, makes the most delicious ground up fiber. You can throw pistachios in there or almonds, delicious. Put it in your smoothie, sprinkle it on salads. And then the chapter 5 is water. You want to be drinking 1/2 gallon of water to 1 gallon of water every day. There's different takes on water. My personal favorite water is distilled water. There's power waters, and there's charged waters, and there's structured waters, and these are all very good. But for most people, distilled water is going to be fine. What you really want to watch out for, though, is tap water, especially fluoridated and chlorinated tap water. Most water is chlorinated. Almost all water is chlorinated. Almost all water is fluoridated. And let me tell you something about fluoride and a chlorine. They are specifically toxic to the glands of the body, especially your brain glands, your thyroid gland, it's not really a brain gland, but it's close, and your pineal gland. The pineal gland is the gland that's responsible for higher consciousness. It's the gland that processes serotonin and processes melatonin. Both melatonin and serotonin have very important spiritual significance.
So-called third eye.
Exactly. Your pineal gland is your third eye. And it, very interestingly, it had been called your third eye by ancient people. But when they found the pineal gland, and they looked, and Descartes called it the seat of the soul, by the way, the pineal gland. But when they found the pineal gland and started to examine it, they actually found eye tissue in the pineal gland, because the pineal gland is sensitive to light. Now, only God knows what a light-sensitive gland is doing flat dab in the middle of your brain. But the point is, it is sensitive to light, and it's involved in serotonin and melatonin metabolism. These are two very important neurotransmitters for higher consciousness. And think about it, by the way, the best-selling drugs in the world, among the best-selling drugs in the world, are serotonin drugs, drugs that manipulate the serotonin system. We're all seem to singularly have these serotonin problems. In any case, the pineal gland, which is responsible for the processing of melatonin and serotonin, is also very, very, very sensitive to fluoride. In fact, the highest concentrations of fluoride in the body are found in this absolutely critical gland that's important for higher consciousness. Now, that smells like conspiracy theory to me, if anything does. Why would they want to have this unbelievably important gland, very possibly the single most important gland in your body, to be fluoridated? Only God knows why that is, and I'm sure you know the story of fluoride in the concentration camp prisoners.
Oh, yeah.
And all that. Exactly.
And Soviets too.
Exactly. Fluoride is a classic dumbing agent, and it's the active ingredient in Prozac and a lot of other serotonin reuptake inhibitors. So if you're taking Prozac, you are fluoridating yourself above and beyond the fluoride that you get from water. So when it comes to water, you want to be super clean with your water, which is why I like distilled water. And you can also use structured waters. Water is important for detoxification. Water is important for the hydraulic system of the body. The vertebrae and the spinal cord are hydraulic systems. Water is important for the cartilage in your joints. Cartilage swells when it contacts water. Water is important for digestive health. Water is important for helping your body, for being able to digest your food. You will feel crappy when you're dehydrated, and you will feel hungry when you're dehydrated. So once again, a great tool for dieters is, the next time you think that you're hungry, go get some water. You could very well just be dehydrated. It could very well be that the water will satisfy your hunger, in addition to the fact that water will swell your stomach and will activate all your satiety, your satisfaction hormones. So chapter 5 is water. And those are your macronutrients, your big nutrients, protein, essential fatty acids, carbohydrates, fiber, and water. The next half of the 8 chapters of Good Nutrition is micronutrients, trace nutrients, things you need, tiny little bits that you could think of as the pixie dust that activates the macronutrients. So you need grams of protein, you need tablespoons of fat, you need grams of carbohydrates, you need grams of fiber, and 1/2 gallon to 1 gallon of water. You could think of vitamins and minerals as the little pixie dust that activates the macronutrients. What's important about the vitamins and minerals is you cannot make them. They come from your diet, which is super critical, because it means if you're not supplementing or you're not getting this stuff from your diet, you're not getting them. In fact, one of the things that we learn in pharmacy school is that what we call diseases are many times nothing more than the manifestations of nutritional deficiencies in these elements that you absolutely must have that you cannot live without. So I like to tell people, you're not sick, you're starving. And nothing demonstrates that more than deficiencies in the trace nutrients. For example, your vitamins. Let's take your water soluble. Your vitamins can be divided into vitamins that dissolve in water. They call them water soluble, the way salt dissolves in water. Or fatty vitamins, vitamins that dissolve in fat. Your water-soluble vitamins are vitamin C and the B complex. Now, vitamin C is so critical for the body that it almost doesn't even, it deserves its own category of nutrients. Vitamin C is made by the entire animal kingdom with the exception of human beings, guinea pigs, and certain primates. And they make a lot of vitamin C. For example, a guinea pig, according to U.S. government statistics, a guinea pig needs 1,500 milligrams, the equivalent of 1,500 milligrams of vitamin C a day in order to live. Now, it doesn't need 1,500 milligrams, it needs the equivalent when you adjust for its body weight. They're going to tell you that the RDA for vitamin C is 60 to 100 milligrams. They're going to tell you that a human being needs 1/15th of the vitamin C that a guinea pig needs, according to the Department of Agriculture's own numbers.
Yeah.
What the heck's wrong with that picture? Now, vitamin C is so phenomenally important for the immune system. It's important for building tissue. It's important for stress. In fact, it may primarily be your body's most important stress vitamin, because when an animal is under stress, it immediately makes more vitamin C. Human beings, for whatever reason, have lost the ability to make vitamin C. If you had to do one thing, just one simple thing for your nutrition, get some vitamin C powder or get the Beyond Tangy Tangerine from Longevity, which contains a big jolt of vitamin C, and drink vitamin C water or Beyond Tangy Tangerine water all day. That's one of the simplest things you could do to create a dramatic change in your health. The second group of, important water-soluble vitamin is the group of vitamins. It's called the B complex. Now, B-complex vitamins are specifically important for the kinds of tissue in your body that moves the fastest, and that is the brain, the heart, the skin, and the digestive system. So any issues around those four parts of the body, the brain, the heart, the skin, the digestive system, depend largely on B-complex, on the vitamins of the B-complex. For example, there's one B vitamin called vitamin B3, niacin. Now, niacin is one of the rare vitamins that your body actually will make under emergency conditions. That's how important niacin is. If you go to medical school, they'll tell you that the deficiency disease caused by niacin deficiency is called pellagra. And the signs of pellagra are known as the four Ds. And the four Ds are diarrhea, dermatitis, dementia, and death. Mm-hmm. Now, these are the four Ds, these are the four symptoms, these are the four signs that you're deficient in niacin. So let's think about it. Diarrhea means you got a GI problem, a digestive problem, right? Well, how many Americans do you know have digestive issues? 60 to 70 million Americans, at least, have digestive issues. Dermatitis, skin diseases, skin rashes. How many people do you know have skin diseases or skin rashes? Dementia, mental problems, forgetfulness, intellectual issues. How many people do you know have problems that way? And then, of course, death. It could very well be that what we consider to be just normal toxicities or side effects or sicknesses or illnesses are nothing more than a simple niacin deficiency, vitamin B3 deficiency. And once you start taking these things, then you'll notice the results. Then you can say for sure that's what causes it. But my point is that simple nutritional deficiencies are connected to what we call the ills of life. To what we call just parts of growing old, just the way it is when you get older. It could be nothing more than simple nutritional deficiencies. And that's just one vitamin, vitamin B3. So the B complex is made up I think it's eight different vitamins. Vitamins B1, B2, B3, B5, B6, B12, folic acid. There's a few other compounds that are similar to the B complex. In any case, the B complex is important for energy, it's important for stress, it's important for mental health. One of the most important roles the B vitamins play in health is in the cardiovascular system. There was a guy, a professor at Harvard named Kilmer McCulley, and when everybody's all screaming about cholesterol, which is really much ado about nothing when it comes to heart disease, the party line in the medical community was, oh, it's fat, it's blood fat, it's cholesterol. Kilmer McCulley, who's a professor at, I think it was at Harvard, he said, no, it's not. It's not cholesterol. cholesterol, it's something called homocysteine. Have you heard of this? Homocysteine?
No.
It's a chemical in the body called homocysteine that's building up in the blood. It turns out that whenever you have heart disease, now, whenever you have heart disease, you don't always have elevated cholesterol, but whenever you have heart disease, you always have elevated homocysteine. So Kilman McCauley was saying, well, I think it's the homocysteine. It's not the cholesterol. And of course, he ended up getting vilified and getting lost his job, and he wrote a couple books on the stuff. But the point about homocysteine is, in order to take care of homocysteine, which is definitively, unlike cholesterol, cholesterol's never been definitively linked to heart disease, but homocysteine has been definitively connected to heart disease. What you need to lower your homocysteine is about a nickel's worth of the B complex every day. That's all you need to take care of your heart. Between vitamin B, between the B complex and vitamin C, you have the large bulk of nutrients that are important for cardiovascular health. Without drugs, without doctors, without insurance companies, without toxicity, without Obamacare. Do you see how powerful this message is? You can use simple nutrients to take care of everything you think you need to go to the doctor for. You can use simple nutrients to bypass every interface that you have with the medical community. You can use simple nutrients to not only bypass all of that, but to feel better, to feel great, to be able to withstand all of the diseases that your friends are dropping dead from, to be able to prevent stroke, to be able to prevent heart attack, to be able to prevent cardiovascular issues, a nickel's worth of B complex every day. I'm telling you, something like the Beyond Tangy Tangerine, which is loaded with the B complex and the vitamin C, is your single most powerful tool to allow
it's
you
got
to
almost
disengage.
Everything in it.
Almost everything.
And then
almost
when you started taking it, you, well, for me anyway, I immediately felt energetic. And then, but as the weeks went on, it helped with my appetite and everything.
Everything else. And that's why, that's such an important point, because we all, we know, I'm vain. We all want to look good. And so we end up focusing on looking good for our supplements. And that's great, because you will look good. But what gets lost sometimes is this idea that you have now reduced your risk of every single disease that you can name. You've improved every single marker of good health. And you've reduced your risk of degeneration. To me, I'm not afraid of dying, but I don't want to degenerate. I don't want to rot. I don't want to get a stroke. I don't want to have an aneurysm. I don't want to have a heart attack. And the last thing I want to do is end up in a hospital where I have to trust the doctor, where I have to rely on his good faith. Do you know when you go to the, one of the first things they do when you go to the hospital is they take you off all your vitamins. They take you off all your supplements so they don't interfere with your drugs.
Well, how, is it through centralization or what? How did they become another center of corrupt priesthood?
I mean, because we as individuals, you and I, have abdicated our authority to the medical model. And by the way, this is a recent phenomenon. At the turn of the 20th century, medical schools and doctoring were not glorified. Medical schools were like little trade schools where you could get a diploma in 2 years. And doctoring was not considered to be this holy, sacred profession. But around 1910, a guy named Abraham Flexner went around to all the medical schools and he created something called the Flexner Report, which mandated that if a medical school was going to get funding by the government or funding by foundations like the Rockefeller Foundation or the Carnegie Foundation, or was going to get funding from drug companies, they had to have a standardized protocol and a standardized curriculum where the doctors would be taught the party line. And that's when all of this started to happen. And the wonderful, warm, fuzzy feelings that we have about doctors, this whole idea like, oh, my son's a doctor, my daughter married a doctor. That all started with the lobbying of the American Medical Association at the turn of the 20th century to the point today, 4 or 5 generations later, we all think that being a doctor is some holy, sacred profession. Now, I want to say that doctors can be nice people, and there's nothing wrong with doctors per se. It's the medical model that is problematic. Secondly, when we have wonderful surgeries, and if I have a heart attack, or if I have a broken leg, or if I get hit by a bus, I want a surgeon. I want a doctor. I don't want vitamins. I want somebody to stitch me up and sew me up. And what I call heroic medicine is wonderful. It's really quite a miracle, and it might be the greatest thing about being alive in the 20th century is that we have the means of being heroic with the medical model. But with day-to-day medicine, with day-to-day health, medicine is an abject 100% total and complete failure. And it is not the job of the doctor to take care of your good health. That is the fundamental message. That is our responsibility. And we have abdicated our responsibility to the men in the white coats because they've told us that they know what they're doing. And what has ended up happening is we are sicker and fatter than ever before. And that is because we have given up our responsibility for our bodies to the point where when we're sick, when we have an allergy, we're willing to go to somebody else to tell us if we're allergic to that food. Mm-hmm. Now, we think that's what food allergy testing is. You have a food allergy, we are so disassociated from our bodies, we're so disconnected from our bodies, that I'm going to go to you and ask you if I'm allergic to something. And what the doctor will do is he'll take a little bit of your blood, he'll put it in a dish, and then he'll put some food in the dish, and he'll say, oh yeah, you're allergic to that food, instead of us knowing what our body is responding to or how our body's responding. We don't even know what our body does, let alone to know if we're allergic or if we're sick from something. So the job that we have as human beings, our most important job, if you ask me, is to understand how our bodies work and how our bodies work vis-a-vis or interfacing with things like food and oxygen and water. To me, that's the single most important thing to do as a human being, is understand how our bodies work.
Look, I've been listening to your radio show. You can find it, at brightsideben.com.
Brightsideben.com.
But I've been trying to put in, start taking these nutritional supplements, and you feel the difference within, almost right away, really.
Almost right away. And that's, that's another good point, Aaron.
And we have it at InfoWarsTeam.com, by the way, the longevity vitamins.
Look at that smiley guy right there.
Yeah, it's a great program, though. I mean, people should really check it out and study what you say, because you've got a lot of wisdom in there.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
More than we could cover in this relatively short interview.
I appreciate that. But you said something very interesting. And this, to me, this is so cool. The sicker you are, the more deficient you are, the faster you recover. The more deficient you are in nutrients, the faster your body absorbs those nutrients. The more weight you need to lose, the faster you lose the weight. To me, that is the great gift of the human body, is the sicker you are, the faster you recover. And your body can turn on a dime if you turn on a dime. I don't care what you have, what your health disease is. I almost don't even, when people call me up on the radio program, I almost don't even want to hear their specific diagnosis. In fact, I think the diagnoses should die, because what diagnosis does is it allows an incompetent medical professional to go to a little book and to see what the appropriate treatment is for your disease. Not to do the medical detective work to figure out where your biochemistry has gone wrong and what exactly is happening inside your body, but to treat you based on a protocol that's been set by the people who are selling you the treatment. The protocols and the drug, the prescribing rituals, the prescribing regime, regimens that are determined for your particular illness are set up by the people who are selling you the drugs. Yeah. The drug companies set up the cholesterol levels, for example, and when your LDL levels went from 100 to 70, they said, if you're at 100, that's good, and then they said, no, it should be 70. That was some advisory board to the FDA that was manned by representatives of the cholesterol-lowering drug companies. So the people who are selling us the medicine are telling us what the standards should be for our health, that the things that they're selling us will treat. So it's a scandal of epic proportions.
Well, this is where I'm at. I mean, politically, philosophically, we know we have to change this thing. We know we can change ourselves individually. How do we begin to fight back against the big pharma problem, the big agri problem?
By not participating, not eating the fast food, not eating the restaurant food, not eating what they're selling you. Not buying what they're selling you. I'm telling you, not eating what they're selling you. And if somebody's selling you food on a commercial, that's a food you probably don't want to eat. If there's a little jingle they're singing, that's a food you probably don't want to eat. Because food value is inversely proportional to the amount of marketing that's spent on that food. They don't market broccoli. They don't market Brussels sprouts. They don't market food that's good for you. They market food that is highly processed. The profit margins on cereals, on crackers, on breads is unconscionable. Because when you buy a box of cereal, for example, what you're basically buying is a box of air. And they say, oh, contents may settle. That box that's this high contains this much food, and if you take out the air out of the flakes or out of the puffs, you get even less food. And that's a box that's going to go for $4, for $5 these days at the supermarket. The profit margin on that stuff is repulsive. And why do you think the biggest companies in the world, like Philip Morris and the cigarette companies, you know what else they own? They own Keebler, and they own Nabisco, and they own the potato chip companies, and they own the snack food companies.
Well, there's more than one reason for that, all the vertical and horizontal integration.
They own all of that stuff, because that food not only is high profit, not only is it high margin, but it also contains chemicals that will keep you eating. Because just like people don't know how to hack into their brains, Food processors know good and well how to hack into your brain, and they know how to hack into your brain so that you'll keep consuming their foods. So the single most important thing you can do, it's not funny to eat potato chips. People think it's a joke, and they say, oh, well, I'm addicted to French fries. Oh, I'm just going to eat my French fries. It tastes delicious. That is participating in the New World Order. That is participating in the machine. That's engaging with the machine. For every French fry you eat, there's another little rivet that is bonding you to the machine of tyranny. So the way you control this stuff is by taking the rivets out, by disengaging from the machine, taking control of your chemistry, because you know what, Aaron? There's nothing more intimate than your biochemistry. There's nothing more intimate to you than your own personal chemistry. And if you let anybody else interfere with that, that is letting somebody into your sovereign space. This is your sovereign space. Your biochemical universe, your biochemical milieu is yours. Your personal. Nobody else has that. There's an Aaron personal biochemistry, there's a Ben personal biochemistry, there's a personal biochemistry for all of us. And if we let somebody get in there, if we let somebody hack into the machinery, we are letting somebody into our sovereign space. And that is the most personal affront that there is.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you take over? You figure out a way that you don't eat the French fries. You figure out a way that you don't eat the potato chips. It's not funny. I hear people make jokes about it. I don't find it personally funny that we're compelled to eat French fries or compelled to eat potato chips. That is a demonstration of the most offensive and egregious intrusion into your sovereign space that is possible.
Well, I agree. And then we have so much problems with the economic situation, all the focus on the housing bubble.
Right.
I mean, this is a huge medical bubble. They make money on the way up and the way down.
Police.
Selling all this food, all the modern diet stuff. But then talk about Big Agra and the medical industry.
GNP.
Excuse me, Big Pharma.
Do you know what the gross national product is? 15% health care. It's trillions of dollars. If we got healthy, 15% of our GNP would go down the tubes. So we have created an economic system that feeds on our sickness, that depends on us being hospitalized. Why do you think there's Obamacare? You think Obamacare is there for people? Obamacare is not there for people. Obamacare is there so you can have guaranteed federal money for drug companies, guaranteed federal money for hospitals, guaranteed federal money for HMOs. It's not there for individual people. If we really cared about individual people, we would have national magnesium insurance, where every American gets 2,000 milligrams of magnesium for being an American. Your tax dollars go to for your nutrition. Your tax dollars go so you can have a massage every week. Your tax dollars go so you can have yogurt every week or some kind of quality food every week. We don't have that. We have a system of healthcare where your tax dollars go to drug companies. Your tax dollars go to hospitals. Your tax dollars go to HMOs and insurance companies.
We hear about all the diarrhea and diseases that could be fixed for pennies in Africa or some third world country, but they spend the money on planned agriculture for GMOs. And
exactly, farming. And we know that our health began to decline as soon as we farm. That's the last thing we want to be doing if we really care about people, is agriculture and teaching them farming techniques. We want to be making sure that everybody has supplementation. To me, it is so simple, Aaron. It's almost negligent for us to not be taking care of a nutritional supplement program, for us not to be incorporating a nutritional supplement program in our life. It's almost like giving in to the New World Order. And I know people don't intentionally mean to do that, but when you eat the French fries and you say, well, I don't supplement, or I'm not going to supplement, or I'm not going to take care of my dietary needs, you're almost giving yourself up. You're almost throwing yourself into the arms of the New World Order. To me, getting on a supplement program, getting on an exercise program, becoming powerful and strong from a nutritional standpoint is the greatest statement you can make against Big Pharma. It's the greatest statement you can make against the New World Order. And by the way, we become docile to the extent that we participate in the food system. We become dumb to the extent that we participate in the food system, and we become sick to the extent that we participate in this food care in our food system. So if you want to be not docile and strong, if you want to be not dumb but smart, you have to figure out a way to control the food you're eating, and the best way to do that is with a nutritional supplement
program. You know about Bertrand Russell, he's a
philosopher.
Yeah, well, he wrote The Impact of Science on Society in about 1950. He said the way they're going to control the populations, there's a lot of quotes, but the key quote, through diet, injections, and injunctions. And injunctions is probably the most obscure of those terms, but that's withholding all this nutritional stuff.
I didn't know that. That's awesome. So he actually said that.
Sense.
He actually said that.
Oh, yeah. It's
he actually admitted it.
Literally keeping us dumbed down.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you know what? There's no excuse to be dumb these days because we have InfoWars. We have the internet. We have people like Alex Jones and yourself who are going out and preaching the message. So just like disease is volitional to a large extent, diabetes is a volitional disease to a large extent, heart disease, high blood pressure, these are choices that we make. Being dumb is a choice also because today, God love the internet, God love InfoWars, God love people who are trying to wake up the American public. We have access to all of this stuff. You almost have to choose to be dumb. You almost have to choose to be blind. You almost have to put blinders on your eyes intentionally if you're going to miss what's right in your face.
Well, I know what you're saying, but it's very easy to get caught up in that false world they build and sell you on TV.
It's
very much part of that Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which I think is an expression of reverse engineering how to control us. I mean, it's what, food and security,
right,
and a few other things that,
right,
keep you from breaking into those higher levels.
Right, they control you at that level.
So if you never get the proper food and,
right,
all the rest of it,
you're still on those lower levels. You're not into self-actualization. That's right. That's right.
Yeah, something
see,
to it.
What you want to do is you want to figure out a way so you can get those lower levels met on your own so that you can go up to self-actualization at the top. But you're right. As long as people are kept hungry, I mean, think about how much time the average person spends just thinking about food. Think about how much time the average person spends spending on food or participating somehow in food.
Yeah.
Think about all the energy you would have, all the time you would have, all the money you would have if you weren't concentrating your energy and your time and your money on your next meal. You know, we have channels on TV that are dedicated to food. That's all they do is food. Food is one of the driving forces of being alive, is somehow making sure you're getting food. Once you start supplementing, once you start getting the nutrients that you need, you will have all this time, all this money, all of this energy that you can spend on self-actualization, on getting smarter, on getting better, because you'll have your nutritional needs met, your fundamental needs met.
Now, look, I know you have a couple more things on your list, what, minerals and trace
minerals? So continue with vitamins, the B-complex and vitamin C, those are your water-soluble vitamins. Your next class of vitamins are your fatty vitamins. These are extremely important because these are your vitamins of healing and regeneration and youth. And those are your fatty vitamins, vitamins D, E, A, and K. We call them DEEK. Vitamin D used to be, they used to tell us in pharmacy school, they said, don't worry about vitamin D because you get it from the sun. Well, today, we don't get vitamin D from the sun because we're all wearing sunscreens and sunblocks. Let me tell you something, Aaron. One of the worst things you can ever put on your skin is a chemical sunscreen. And if you're using a chemical sunscreen because you're protecting yourself from the sun, first of all, you should have better ways to protect yourself from the sun. Eating your vegetables is one of the best, and getting antioxidants and nutrients is one of the best. But if you're using a sunscreen, as soon as you get home, wash that thing off, because the stuff in a sunscreen is so toxic and so deadly that when I buy it in my pharmacy, because I have to make products with it, it has a skull and crossbones on it.
Yeah.
And if you were to drink that sunscreen out of the bottle, the actual sunscreen ingredient, you would die or have your stomach pumped. And I know you're putting it on your skin, and it's not like you're eating it, but do you really want to put that kind of deadly compound on your skin? I think not. So vitamin D deficiency today, unfortunately, is very common, largely because people are terrified of the sun. Interestingly, vitamin D is made from cholesterol. So if you're taking a drug that is knocking out your body's ability to make cholesterol, your vitamin D levels will immediately suffer. So vitamin D is extremely important for the immune system. It's important for how cells divide and grow. Vitamin D is chemotherapy. It's used to treat cancer. Vitamin D is amazing, amazing stuff. Vitamin E is important for the cardiovascular system, for the heart. It's important for the brain. It's important for sun protection. It's an anti-inflammatory. If you want to heal really fast, if you pop a zit or you have a wound, a burn, and you have to go to some party and you don't want to have this zit or wound on your face, super high doses of vitamin E are amazingly healing. And my super high dose is 1,000 international units, 2,000 international units a day of vitamin E. Vitamin E, by the way, comes in 8 different forms, and they're all important. And if you buy the cheapo kind of vitamin E, you're not going to get those 8 different forms. Vitamin K, important for bone health and for calcium metabolism and for wound for bruising. And then vitamin A is arguably the single most important vitamin in your body. Vitamin C may be close. Vitamin A is important for the immune system. It's important for skin health, for the liver, endlessly important. Here's the problem with these fatty vitamins. Remember I talked about fat malabsorption, how many people don't absorb their fats. If you suffer from fat malabsorption issues, you immediately will have your vitamin A levels, vitamin D levels, vitamin E levels, and vitamin K levels compromised because you're not going to be able to absorb those things. So it is absolutely critical to straighten out any fat malabsorption problems for these vitamins. Also, supplementing can help you bypass some of those malabsorption problems, although you'll still have a little bit of problems if you have malabsorption with vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin E, and K levels. Now, vitamin A also is anti-cancer, and topically, vitamin A is tremendous for acne and tremendous for psoriasis, same with vitamin D. Then your minerals, those are like the batteries that run everything else. You know, they found a battery in Iraq, which used to be Mesopotamia. They actually found a battery that was 2,500 years old. You hear about this?
Yeah.
Yeah. So how you say, well, gosh, these were ancient people. How did they know about batteries? They knew that minerals conduct electricity. And it wasn't until the 1700s that here in the West, or maybe the late 1600s, no, actually it was the end of the 1700s, when Alexander Volta in Italy discovered the same thing, that minerals conduct electricity. So when you eat your minerals or drink your minerals, however you're getting your minerals, you are literally drinking electrical energy. But electrical energy at different frequencies. Each mineral conducts energy at a different frequency, and there's 80 plus different minerals, depending on who you ask, and they all come off the periodic table. Mineral deficiency should not happen because minerals are in the soil. And when you eat the plants, when you eat the vegetables, you're supposed to get the minerals. Well, of course, today, because of soil erosion and poor farming techniques, the minerals aren't in the soil. Consequently, they're not in the vegetables. So many people are mineral deficient, to the point where by the 1920s, it was even politicians knew that mineral deficiencies were a problem. The best way to get your minerals, and there's two different kinds of minerals, I should tell you. There's macro minerals, there's minerals you need larger amounts of, and then there's trace minerals. The best way to get your minerals from foods is from vegetables. The best way to get your minerals in supplementation is from liquid supplements. Now, there are some minerals that you need large amounts of, and one in particular stands out in importance, and that's zinc. Yeah. Zinc deficiency is extremely common, and it's almost tragic because you can get your zinc needs met with a 50 milligram capsule, which costs you less than 10 cents at your average health food store. And zinc is involved in 200 different chemical reactions in your body. Magnesium is involved in 300 different chemical reactions in the body, and zinc deficiency and magnesium deficiency are more common than not. So between two minerals alone, you have 500 different chemical reactions in your body.
Who's going in pairs, though, by the way?
Minerals come in pairs, that's right. Well, not all of them, but there are mineral pairs. Zinc is paired with copper, calcium is paired with magnesium. So different minerals are paired with each other, and that's one of the things about supplementing is it's a little tricky to get these pairs together, and that's why I like supplement systems like the longevity system is the pairs are taken care of for you. But the point I want to make about zinc is it is so tragic that people suffer from zinc deficiency, which can cause immune problems and skin problems and bone problems and digestive problems, liver problems and adrenal problems. It's so tragic because it takes so little to get yourself on a zinc supplement. You just go to a health food store and buy a bottle of 100 zinc capsules for less than 10 bucks. So minerals are extremely important. They activate vitamins. Mineral deficiencies are extremely common. The last chapter is accessory nutrients. There's a bunch of them. One of my favorites is something called NAC for N-acetylcysteine. NAC is the number one most important supplement you could take for liver toxicity. Many people suffer from liver toxicity. NAC has a way of combining with mercury and other toxic minerals, helping it pass through your body. Another very important trace nutrient that people should be taking is good bacteria or probiotics. Yeah. Now, I've been talking about probiotics for a long time. And I was very gratified to see Jamie Lee Curtis on TV talking about probiotics also, because now even drug companies know that probiotics are so powerful and so cheap and so dramatically effective that you can actually buy them at a grocery store, probiotics. You're not going to get the good stuff at a grocery store. You're going to get the watered-down stuff at a grocery store. But that shows you how powerful this stuff is, that even drug companies know that they could sell you probiotics. And let me tell you something. There is nothing that will take care of your digestive problems faster than a good probiotic supplement. I like the Biolumin Nightly Essence from Longevity, but there's a lot of good probiotic supplements. If you have Crohn's disease, celiac disease, any kind of ulcerative colitis or any kind of irritable bowel syndrome problems, get yourself on a probiotic supplement. It is unbelievable how fast those things will work for digestive problems within a day in many cases.
Okay, well, hold on right there, because I know I, for one, get really confused once we get down the alphabet and all the technical names. But first of all, your radio show, Brightside, Ben, you really break it down. I've listened a lot to it.
Thank you.
Just learned so much. But the other is at Youngevity, the Youngevity line of vitamins.
Right.
Alex has the website, InfoWarsTeam.com. You can get the Beyond Tanking Tangerine that has almost all these stuff we're talking
about.
Well,
we made it simple. The Alex Pack is a very simple way to interface with these nutrients, to get involved with these nutrients. No, like you say, it can be a little bit confusing. And I understand. I've been doing this for 30 years, and so I have a way of grasping it that the average person isn't going to be able to grasp. You don't have to study nutrition for 30 years in order to participate this way. The Alex Pact is an easy way to get the Beyond Tangy Tangerine, the Ultimate EFAs, the Essential Fatty Acids, and the Magnesium and Calcium, Liquid Magnesium and Calcium, and the Osteo FX. It costs around $112 a month. It is the best investment in your health you will make. It is half the price of your average 30-day prescription cost. Now, I know some people are on insurance and they're paying only $10 or $20 copay, but for $112 a month, which is about less than $4 a day, you can have all your nutritional needs met, and if you have any kind of health issue, whether it's diabetes or high blood pressure or whatever it is, you can notice an immediate change once you start to take these products. Now, I'm not going to tell you you're going to reverse absolutely everything right away. That's not necessarily going to happen until you've been participating in it for a while, but you'll notice a difference right away. Almost everybody notices differences within days of getting on the Alex Pack and the products in the Alex Pack.
And metaphorically, you're going to slash and cut through the vines of the jungle in terms of your interaction with the big
I love
big
it, with the machine.
Industry,
you're going to de-rivet. You're going to get those bolts out
of there.
Yeah,
so we're going to spend a couple minutes. Obviously, we can't cover it all. They should check out your radio show for more. But some of the specific diseases, I want to start with the gut, because I was real surprised to learn just a couple years ago how much of the immune system is located in the gut.
Isn't that amazing? 80%.
And by the way, is there something to the intuition in the gut? I don't know.
Oh, yeah, there is. Your gut has a brain. Your most important, or one of your most important neurotransmitters is serotonin. But the large majority of serotonin is produced in your digestive system. Your digestive system is your second brain. In fact, there's a book called The Second Brain, which talks about the intelligence of the digestive system. You know, the ancient Greeks, they used to do autopsies and they used to look at dead bodies, and they actually thought that the digestive system was a separate animal that lived in your body.
Yeah.
It has its own brain, it has its own nervous system, it has its own neurotransmitters, it has its own immune system, and it's independent from the rest of your body. It's connected to the rest of your body through a little area in your small intestine, which is actually one of the keys to being healthy, is to understand that connection between the digestive system and the rest of your body. But your point is very, very well taken. First of all, what is your immune system? Your immune system is your body's defense system, right? It's supposed to fight the enemy. Well, where does most of the enemy get into your body?
Through the gut.
Through what you eat. So, of course, the largest part of your immune system is going to be located in the digestive system. And just to show you how dramatic this is, there is a surgical procedure that tens of thousands of little children, of 10 and 12-year-old children, have every year. It's a surgical procedure where they remove part of your immune system.
Yeah.
And this part of your immune system, by the time a kid is 10 or 12 years old, is so inflamed and it's so puffed up with pus and with white blood cells and with inflammatory factors and immune factors that it clogs the airways. This little part of the immune system becomes swollen, just like a big pimple, and it blocks the kid's ability to breathe. So the kid has to go in and have a surgical procedure to remove that. That's called a tonsillectomy. And what we're talking about is the tonsils, which are part of your immune system. Your tonsils are a part of your immune system that becomes big and inflamed and swollen for 10 years or 12 years of eating the wrong food. And this is a demonstration. We see it in the tonsils, but it happens in the rest of the body as well.
Yeah.
That inflammation, that immune reaction, is happening in all throughout the lymphatic system. Lymphatic system is your body's sewage system. It's transporting waste material. Do you ever watch those Civil War shows or Civil War documentaries where they'll show you the dead bodies that were piling up in the Civil War? I mean, you understand history. In the Civil War, that was the most horrific, ugliest war, and there were dead bodies at Gettysburg and in Shiloh and these different war sites. They would pile up the dead bodies, sometimes tens of thousands of dead bodies. And these war sites with the dead bodies would be filled with flies and smell, and the bodies would be exploding, and there'd be bacteria everywhere. It's just the most horrific, disgusting scene, right? Well, guess what? That's what your immune system looks like after years of abuse. Because when your immune system is activated and it's fighting the enemy, it's producing white blood cells and infectious material, and it's killing things. And when a cell dies, it emits gases, and it emits chemicals. And as millions of cells die, they emit lots of gases and lots of chemicals and lots of the chemical equivalent of flies and things surrounding them. So over the course of time, our circulatory system and our immune system and our lymphatic system become like a Civil War battlefield with dead bodies and pus and infectious material and chemicals. And that stuff starts to accumulate in the circulatory system, and the blood doesn't move as effectively, and you don't get oxygenated as effectively, and it starts to accumulate in the lymphatic system, and you don't get nutriated as effectively, and fats can't move through effectively, and it starts to accumulate in joints, and then the body starts to attack the joints. And so over the course of time, as our immune system becomes clogged and our immune system becomes activated, we start to break down. Our body can't get nourished as well. Our tissues can't get oxygenated as well. Poisons start to accumulate, and that's what we call the death and disease process, and it's all secondary to an activated immune system, which itself is secondary from problems with the digestive system.
But, I mean, you brought up probiotics. That's very important for specifically the digestive system.
Absolutely, absolutely. One of the ways we process food is by bacteria that live in the colon. And those bacteria are supposed to be populated initially through breast milk. Mm-hmm. But when we're born, if we don't get breastfed, if we're not getting breast milk, or if our mother doesn't give us breast milk long enough, she weans us too early, or if we are breastfed but our mothers weren't healthy, all of a sudden, our digestive system and our probiotic population is not as healthy as well. Yeah. And that means we don't detoxify substances, because probiotics are important for detoxification. Probiotics are important for elimination. You know, the large bulk of your stool is probiotic. It's bacteria. Mm-hmm. 70% of your turd is actually made up of bacteria. If you don't have probiotics, that's a recipe for constipation. And it never ceases to amaze me how many people think it's normal to have two bowel movements or less a week. Probiotics are one of the fastest ways you can improve your elimination. Probiotics also make the B complex. They also make vitamin K. They also make vitamin A. So if you're deficient in probiotics, number one, you're not going to detoxify substances as well. Number two, you're not going to be eliminating as well. And number three, you've lost a major source of nutrients. So probiotic supplementation is key.
Well, I wanted to bring this up about the gut. I know the great crew we have found it. It's the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Not only do they focus so much of the resources on vaccinations for the whole world, but they did a lot of research on the immune system in the gut and its specific reaction with vaccines.
That's
and so much more. Do you guys have that? More than 88 grants. I'm not sure what year this is. I think I spot checked 210 going from memory. But anyway, it has a great deal to do with, I'm not sure if it's here on the screen, I'd have to read the details, but you can look up their research grants, and a large portion of them, I would say between a third and half, have to do with the gut and the immune system that's located in the digestive system.
That's so fascinating.
As far as fighting back against the machine, I find that pretty troubling.
Bill and Melinda Gates.
Good friends. Yeah, I know there's a lot more to cover. We wanted to talk about obesity and diabetes.
Right. A lot of obesity and diabetes affect 1 out of 3 Americans. And they're choice diseases, they're choice illness, they're choice dysfunctions. If you're obese or you're overweight, and I think obesity is 20 pounds or more overweight, and 1 out of 3 Americans is considered obese and overweight, and the numbers are rising. The single most important strategy, and there's a lot of different strategies, but the single most important strategy for helping you reduce weight is to replace your carbohydrates, your refined carbohydrates, with protein, which we talked about earlier. The single most important step you can make is to replace your refined carbohydrates with protein. Now, keep in mind, body fat produces female hormone, the female hormone estrogen, and the estrogen makes you slothful and slow and lazy and not want to work and not want to work out. So the more body fat you're carrying, the harder it's going to be to exercise and the harder it's going to be to go out and move. So it's almost like a vicious circle, because then you get more body fat and that makes it harder to move, and then you get more body fat and that makes it harder to move. In order to break that cycle, it's critical to reduce the amount of body fat that you're carrying. Mm-hmm. because once you reduce the amount of body fat you're carrying, you'll have more energy to do things, and that will help you reduce more body fat, and you can reverse that vicious circle, take it the other way. In order to start the ball rolling, to turn that circle around, it's key to reduce body fat. The best way to do that is to reduce your refined carbohydrates and get yourself on more protein. That's the quickest way to do that. Mm-hmm. Secondly, you're going to want to reduce the amount of processed fats, and the fastest way to do that is to get yourself on essential fatty acids. And thirdly, you're going to want to reduce the amount of the wrong kinds of salts, wrong kinds of salty foods, and you do that by taking in more minerals. Here's a little trick for you. If you, and by the way, you have a gland in your body called your adrenal glands, and your adrenal glands are responsible for helping you handle stresses, emotional stresses, psychological stresses, or physiologic stresses. When your adrenal glands are overworked, you're going to crave salt. One of the kindest, sweetest things you can do for your adrenal glands is to make sure you're taking good minerals, like the colloidal minerals from Youngevity, the Ultimate Classic, or the Tangy Tangerine, especially the mineral zinc. Here's a little trick for you if you just want to demonstrate to yourself how effective this can be. Get yourself some Celtic sea salt, put it in water, and then sip on Celtic sea salt all day long. You will reach a point where you can no longer drink any more salt. That's when you know you've had enough salt. But until you've reached that point, not only will you notice that your salt cravings are going away, but you'll notice that you feel better. You notice that you have more energy and you have a stronger ability to withstand stress. Now, Celtic sea salt's not perfect. It's a good source of salt, but it doesn't have all the minerals you need. But it's a good way to demonstrate how effective it is, how powerful it is, and how quickly powerful it is to get yourself on a mineral supplement program. The best minerals are going to be colloidal liquid minerals like in the Beyond Tangy Tangerine or the Ultimate Classic or those products.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's relatively quickly talk about diabetes and blood pressure.
Again, diabetes is a blood sugar issue, and by the way, elevations in cholesterol are connected to blood sugar and insulin problems. There's two factors occurring when you have diabetes. One is a problem with the body's blood sugar levels, and one is a problem with the body's insulin levels. The body doesn't like quick burning. The body likes slow burning. Sugar represents quick burning. If you put a marshmallow in a flame, what happens to that marshmallow? Yeah. Poof, right? Explodes quickly because sugar burns fast and it burns hot. You ever get a sugar burn? It burns super, super hot. So the body has evolved a system for yanking that sugar out of the blood because sugar is very dangerous stuff. It's going to cause fires. It'll specifically cause fires with protein, and protein and sugar react in a burning reaction. So the body's evolved a very elaborate system for getting that sugar out of your blood. And that elaborate system involves the hormone insulin. So when you eat sugar, the body goes, oh my God, a fire, let's get some insulin. The insulin takes the sugar out of your blood and stores it. It stores it as fat. So then you're low blood sugar, right? So you say, well, what am I going to do? I'm tired, I'll go get some more sugar. You get some more sugar, the body goes, oh my God, a fire, let's get some insulin, it pulls the sugar out of your blood again, you're low blood sugar. And you end up on this vicious spiral of high blood sugar, low blood sugar, high blood sugar, low blood sugar, high blood sugar, low blood sugar, and it's all being controlled by the hormone insulin. Now insulin, in addition to being a hormone that yanks sugar out of your blood, is also involved in making cells divide and making you grow. So when your insulin levels go high, your cells will start to divide very fast, and you will get bigger and bigger and bigger. If you're not doing it correctly, that bigger and bigger and bigger means more fat. Now eventually your body's going to say, well, I don't want to listen to insulin anymore, because insulin keeps going up and it becomes insulin resistant. And then you make more insulin. And then your body goes through that whole high blood sugar, low blood sugar cycle, and eventually your body stops listening to that insulin. And so what happens over the course of time is your body completely stops listening to insulin. And now you have elevated blood sugar, and now your body's not listening to insulin, and now the sugar is burning a fire in your body, and you have lost your mechanism for getting the sugar out of your blood. That's called diabetes. Diabetes is a disease that occurs over the course of time when the body stops listening to insulin. It becomes resistant to insulin. It's called insulin resistance. So what happens with insulin resistance is not only have you lost your blood sugar control, and now you have all these fires going on in your body. By the way, the technical term for those fires is glycation, and glycation occurs in little blood vessels in your eyes, and that causes blindness, and diabetes is the leading cause of blindness. Glycation can occur in little blood vessels in your feet, and diabetes is one of the leading causes of amputations. Glycation, this burning reaction, can occur to the microscopic blood vessels in your kidneys, and diabetes is a leading cause of kidney disease. When your insulin goes up, insulin can cause, because it makes cells divide, insulin will make cholesterol levels go up. So now you've got blindness, you've got amputations, you've got kidney disease, you've got elevated blood fats, and it's all secondary to blood sugar and insulin. The fastest way to protect yourself from circulatory problems, the fastest way to protect yourself from elevated blood fats and cholesterol, the fastest way to protect yourself from obesity is to drop your blood sugar and make your body more sensitive to insulin. How do you make your body more sensitive to insulin? How do you drop your blood sugar? Once again, all roads lead to restricting the sugar and the refined carbohydrates and replacing it with protein. If you're concerned about cholesterol, if you're concerned about blood fat, if you're concerned about eye problems, problems with the extremities, circulatory problems of all kinds, including cardiovascular problems, heart problems, the best thing you can do is restrict your sugar and make your body more sensitive to insulin. And you can do that in several ways. One of the best is with vitamins and nutrients. The B vitamins are your best friend if you have diabetes, your absolute best friend to protect you from cardiovascular issues, your absolute best friend to help you lower your cholesterol if that's what you so desire. And not a single one of these strategies, Aaron, requires a prescription drug. Not a single one. We haven't even mentioned a prescription drug. There is no time other than an emergency when you need to be on a prescription drug for life. If your doctor has told you that you're going to be on this high blood pressure drug for the rest of your life, you're going to be on this cholesterol-lowering statin drug for the rest of your life, he has not followed, he does not understand biochemistry. There's not a single prescription drug that can do what any of these nutrients are doing that we're talking about. And that's why I do this as a pharmacist, because my interest is medicinal chemistry. My interest is the chemistry of medicine. And there is no finer medicine than a nutritional supplement. A nutritional supplement is what a drug dreams it could be. If a drug goes to bed at night and has a fantasy, it pretends it's vitamin C. Because a vitamin or a nutrient has all the properties of a drug with none of the side effects and no toxicities.
Incredible.
Incredible, right?
Not to mention a big violation of the Hippocratic Oath.
The Hippocratic Oath says, I will give no toxin. I will give nothing lethal.
No,
I will do no harm. I will give nothing to a patient, including drugs. The Hippocratic Oath mentions drugs. It says, I will give no drugs that cause toxicity. And yet we've created this entire model that depends on prescription medicine.
We have massive society-wide problems here, but this is a big part of it.
This is true.
You also know a lot about skin, but check out brightsideben.com for that. You want to give us a quick highlight on that?
Skin is so easy to treat because the skin divides more rapidly than any other tissue in the body, save the digestive system. And the skin and the digestive system have real interesting connection. Both the skin and the digestive system turn over super, super fast. The skin turns over every 4 to 8 weeks, which means if you have zits today, 4 to 8 weeks from now, you do not have to have those zits. If you have eczema today, 4 to 8 weeks from now, you don't have to have eczema. If you have any skin issue, 4 to 8 weeks from now, that skin issue can be gone because the skin cells are constantly turning over. The number one reason why the skin reacts, whether you're dealing with eczema or psoriasis or rosacea or acne, the number one reason why the skin reacts in a disease state is because of nutritional deficiencies or food allergies. And those are the two easiest things to take care of. For nutritional deficiencies, get yourself nutrients. For food allergies, eliminate the allergens. And I'm talking, your breakouts can be gone. And let me tell you, the joy in somebody's face when you make their zits go away, when you don't make them, but you tell them what to do to have their skin clear up, the joy is indescribable. And when I see somebody who's broken out and they come to me, I get excited because I know that they will see for themselves how powerful this kind of supplementation program can be. I know that they're going to have their own personal demonstration of the effectiveness of a good nutritional supplement program. So I get excited when I see somebody come into my office or come into my pharmacy with eczema or psoriasis or acne or some kind of skin issue because they're so easy to treat. And they happen. The treatment, the remedies occur so fast.
But to put it in short, whatever your problem is, if you start taking these vitamin supplements, you're going to have positive results almost
quickly. Quickly, yes.
Well, it's at InfoWarsTeam.com, and Ben Fuchs' show is BrightsideBen.com. It's also on the GCN network. Really recommend checking it out. That's all for this extended interview. Check out part one from Monday, December the 12th as well. Thanks and good night. InfoWarsNews.com.